Dr. M. S. Swaminathan would now deliver his lecture. Before that, there's a brief introduction of the distinguished speaker of the evening, and I hope I'm going to do justice to this. Professor M. S. Swaminathan, the founder of the M. S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, has been acclaimed by Time magazine as one of the 20 most influential Asians of the 20th century and one of the only three from India, the other two being Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore. He has been described by the United Nations Environment Programme as the father of economic ecology because of his leadership of the ever-green revolution movement in agriculture. He was the chairman of the UN Science Advisory Committee set up in 1980 to take follow-up action on the Vienna Plan of Action. He also served as independent chairman of the FAO Council from 1981 to 1985, and the President of the International Union for the Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, 1984 to 1990. He was President of the World Wide Fund for Nature India from 1989 to 1996. He also served as the President of the Pugwash Conferences on Science in World Affairs 2002 to 2007, President of the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, and Chairman, National Commission on Farmers. He was a trustee of the Bibliotheca Alexandrina in its formative years. Professor Swaminathan served as Director of the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, Director General of the Indian Council of Agricultural Research, and Secretary to the Government of India, Department of Agricultural Research and Education, Principal Secretary, Ministry of Agriculture, Acting Deputy Chairman and later Member of Scientific Agriculture Planning Commission 1980-82 and Director General, International Rice Research Institute in the Philippines. A plant genetist by training, Professor Swaminathan's contribution to the agricultural renaissance of India have led to him being widely referred to as the scientific leader of the Green Revolution movement. His advocacy of sustainable agriculture leading to an evergreen revolution makes him an acknowledged world leader in the field of sustainable food security. The International Association of Women in Development conferred on him the first international award for significant contributions to promoting the knowledge, skill and technological empowerment of women in agriculture and for his pioneering role in mainstreaming gender considerations in agriculture and rural development. Professor Swaminathan was awarded the Raman Magsaysay Award for Community Leadership in 1971, the Albert Einstein World Science Award in 1986, the first World Food Prize in 1987, and Volvo Tyler and UNEP Sasakawa Prize for Environment, the Indira Gandhi Prize for Peace, Disarmament and Development in the year 2000, and the Franklin D. Roosevelt Four Freedoms Medal, the Mahatma Gandhi Prize of UNESCO in 2000, and the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Award in 2007. He is the recipient of the Padma Shri in 1967, Padma Bhushan in 1972, and Padma Vibhushan in 1989. A fellow of many leading scientific academies of India and around the world, including the Royal Society of London and the US National Academy of Sciences, Professor Swaminathan has received 73 honorary doctorate degrees from universities around the world. The most recent honorary degree is from the University of Faisalabad, Pakistan, which is also one of the oldest agricultural universities in the subcontinent. He currently holds the UNESCO Chair in Ecotechnology at the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation in Chennai. He was a member member of the Parliament of India Rajya Sabha during 2007-2013. During 2010-2013, he chaired the high-level panel of experts of the World Committee on Food Security. He also chaired the task force set up by the Ministry of External Affairs to oversee the projects undertaken in Afghanistan and Myanmar in the field of agriculture. During 2013, Professor Swaminathan received the Indira Gandhi Award for National Integration and Greatest Global Living Legend Award of NDTV. He was also elected at the 20th International Congress of Nutrition held at Granada, Spain, as the Living Legend of International Union of Nutrition Sciences. He has also received the Lifetime Achievement Award at the 9th Nutra Summit in Bangalore. I guess we all are so privileged to have you, sir, this evening, and I am sure it's going to really benefit us. And over to you, sir, and a big round of applause from all of us and happy welcome.
Thank you. And thank you for the presentation, for keeping half the audience out and hearing what I say. Very kind of you for the very extensive introduction to my work. Thank you for your research. I am very grateful to you. Distinguished members, both in audience and those visiting here. First of all, I want to thank the Foundation for Agrarian Studies and asking me to be the first lecturer in this evening. If you look at really need the focus of presentation, and also if you look at that program, you'll find they are filling an important gap in the country. We are all studying land and issues and so on, but they have gone to the micro level and they try to do their best to examine the problems of these very small farmers, landless labor, and how to solve them. So I congratulate them, wish them well in their program. I'm going to talk a few examples because I find there's some time for discussion. So a few examples of science in relation to agriculture as well. I think the mention was made by Ramsen Pillai about science. You know, Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister, used to always say, the future belongs to science and to those who make friendship with science. The future belongs to science and to those who make friendship with science. That's very true even today, is very important. How did it go so far? You know, in the middle of our independence, with the Bengal famine of 1961 and so on, there was a lot of skepticism all over the world about India's ability to feed itself. They thought we had laid a ship to mouth existence. For example, the famous population expert, Ehrlich, and Paul Ehrlich, he said sometime between 1970 and 85, the world will undergo vast famines. Hundreds of millions of people are going to starve to death. That is, they will starve to death unless plague, trouble, a war, or some other agent kills them first. The United States should announce that they no longer ship food to countries that are in India. So a dispassionate analysis indicates that the imbalance between food and population is open. Population is growing, production is not growing. And he is a very responsible man. Ehrlich is not a well-known population expert. So the number of books and number of articles of this kind at that time. In fact, I remember in 1964 I had only one day symposium on the topic proving prophets are going wrong. The topic of the symposium was proving these prophets are going wrong. People like Ehrlich, how to prove them wrong. What is an opportunity, how to do it, and so on. So in science also there are what we call transformational science. Something which triggers the whole set of other activities.
You initiate one action, it leads to many action. For example, the mental, the laws of genetics prove to be a wide-ranging application. From microbes to man, then the principles of genetics apply. Then came molecular genetics, Watson and Crick, 1943. And then a whole series of developments, whichever I find out in the large young people, and you know, many, many people. But one of the more recent, very important developments is the implementation of genome editing. When we first doubt that, there are a number of people who are involved in this genome editing, from GMO to genome editing. In other words, yes, one very important point is there is no introduction of alien germplasm. It is modification of the existing germplasm. To the extent, it does not require the same kind of regulatory mechanism, except ethical issues. Where to apply it in medicine, particularly, where this technology has become important. The question is largely an ethical question. So can you do this, can you not do that, and so on. Well, when our independence is basically pregnant of all time, there are 2 to 3 million children, women and men died. Partly it was caused by the Japanese occupation of Myanmar. It was used to get rice from Myanmar, and that was stopped after the Japanese occupation. From the Bengal famine to National Food Security Act, today we are one of the few countries in the world which has conferred a legal right to food through Act of Parliament, Food Security Act. The Food Security Act has a number of interesting features. It looks at the life cycle from birth to death. It also recognizes the role of women in food security by saying that the food security entitlement document will be in the hands of the senior most woman in the household. There is also a development of the food basket. How many were the wheat and rice? Now millet, jowar, bajra, many other crops are also being included in the PDS. The entitlement is from 5 kilograms per month. Well, I want you to realize a country which was considered to be by Ehrlich and others as hopeless country, it cannot feed itself. Today is the only country probably in the world which has a legal, which has conferred a legal right to food. It's a confirmation for which we owe both our farmers, societies, and political leaders also, because much of the public policy, as I will show later, is done at a political level. Public policy, okay, that it is own wisdom and authority, it is designed as a public policy. One example of science is the science of evolution and the means of evolution. This was caused by changing the architecture of the plant. Both the physiology and the anatomy and the morphology of the plant was changed. For example, both material wheat and rice, the height was shortened. With the result, you can apply with no water, no fertilizer. In other words, inputs are needed for output. Unless you can feed the plant, you can't take more yield. How do you feed the plant more? If it is going to be very tall, it will fall down. And that is why the short varieties became very important. Incidentally, the dwarf wheat came from Japan and the dwarf rice came from China. Those are the genetic material, not the variety. Today we have a large number of varieties in China. Then came what is called the Green Revolution. Today, the Green Revolution word was coined by Mr. William Clark of the United States in 1968, when Indira Gandhi released a stamp called the Green Revolution. You see that stamp here, it's one of the philatelist prize stamp. It is still available with postal people. What was the, we call it the symphony, a symphony universal concern, where there should be no jarring sound at all. all have to go by one unity goal. Technology is the primary objective. Services are needed to take the technology to the poorest farmer, like what our foundation is trying to do. The public policy is in input-output pricing, export-import policy in particular. Input-output pricing and export-import policy are very important. They go on. You and I can sit in this room, hear lectures, shows like where the people are actually producing the food or in the field. In sun and rain, they work both men and women, and therefore farmers getting involved is exceedingly important. Without it, it is not good. When the Green Revolution was all right, but even before the Green Revolution term was coined, Rachel Carson, she Silent Spring, most of you have read that book, she cautioned against the environmental implications of modern technology, particularly DDT and 2,4-D, many of these, the herbicide, the pesticide, DDT. It's got the Nobel Prize, for example, DDT for the Nobel Prize, the inventor of DDT. But the fact remains that she said all these are causing what was called silence, but the birds are not there, the butterflies are not there, more and more damage to the environment. And Albert Schweitzer, who also is a Nobel laureate, when he read that article of Rachel Carson, he made a mention, man has lost the capacity to foresee and to forestall, he will end by destroying the earth. We are not able to, if you are a scientist, you should look at the consequences, not only the good ones which you want, but also what are the other. For example, I just quoted. So I asked you, if you are interested, you can take copies from the organizers, from the foundation. What I said was at that time, before the world Green Revolution was coined, if you are not careful ecologically, unless you integrate ecology with technology development, it will be difficult to. If you have the same variety of crop in large areas, then you have a problem. Genetic homogeneity is always just genetic heterogeneity is important to avoid pests and diseases. So there are a number of issues of world. The soil health care, today the government of India is giving soil health card to people. But the card has to be, along with the card, the means to apply the principles behind the card are required. Since Green Revolution was being debated and discussed, by one hand the economists felt that many of the smaller farmers will not have the capacity to buy the needed input, including the cost of the seed. Every year they were keeping their own seed. And then the ecologist said ecologically it is dangerous. Soil health will be affected, groundwater depletion and so on. So I coined the term European Revolution. That is increasing productivity in perpetuity without ecological harm. In other words, if you are a young scientist today working in agriculture, you have to think of how to improve the productivity of crops without damaging the environment or without harm to the long-term production potential. This is what Evergreen Revolution. There I have one or two books on this topic from Green to Evergreen Revolution. Those who are interested, you can go through it in greater detail. Speaking of food security, which has come to mean certain amount of calories, there is the concept of nutrition security is more important, particularly the micronutrients, iron, zinc, iodine, and all of the whole area of micronutrients, what we call hidden hunger. Then there is protein hunger as a result of inadequate consumption of protein, particularly muscle. So, how do you approach the micronutrients? In other words, then what we need is nutrition security, a balanced nutrition, and not only food security in the sense of calories alone. Calories are important, but there are both protein hunger and hidden hunger. I'm glad a number of people now are getting interested in millets and so on, the ragi and Cranberry village of Commentary Court. They know how to challenge the three major approaches of biofortification. One is actually biofortified plants like moringa, sweet potato, millets, fruits and vegetables and so on. There is also biofortified varieties which can be carried by breeding. And finally, more genetically modified, biofortified crops like golden rye. Golden rye, most of you will have read about it. A lot of controversy about golden rye. And there are several pathways of introducing the weapon of this. There is no biofortified crops. Biofortification, I told you, any of you want to have it with the moringa plant, Murugakai is a really wonderful plant. It's got all the nutrients, micronutrients. In fact, the National Geographic said it's sort of a miracle crop. And everybody can grow the moringa in their own compound. In little space, your two plants can grow. Otherwise, you can ensure that your forest is concerned. There is also other crops, sweet potato for example. You have extraordinary economic growth in South Asia. Population is largely dependent upon agriculture. Yet two out of five children, 40% are standing. Women and children suffer more from hunger and anguish. How are we going to overcome these problems? I mentioned about three major dimensions of hunger. There is calorie deprivation, there is protein deficiency, micronutrient deficiency. Calorie deprivation can be overcome in a country. So long as it is, if the Food Security Act is implemented properly, then we will be able to have the minimum calories that we need. That is how it has been developed. But what about protein hunger? More consumption of it. More content of your culture, or create, or milk, and other products. Micronutrient deficiency, they already mentioned the whole thing, the iron, and their biofortification and health. In other words, if there's a problem, they don't need solution, and it's important to understand the solution. It is implementable, it is affordable. It should not be a solution, it is extremely expensive. And design is what they call a farming system for nutrition, because farmers operate with farming systems. There will be crops, there will be livestock, sometimes there will be fish and so on. Crops of this are annual crop and perennial crop and crops of food. So farming system for nutrition is the method that we are introducing the concept of nutrition in the farming system. In agriculture, there will be nutritional management. It could be iron deficiency, it could be calcium deficiency, what kind of plant. In other words, if there is a student in the college, then what is the problem, nutrition problem? Next is what is the solution, what kind of solution, from the agriculture side, from the crop side. And you will find for every one of them there is.
Don't keep it down when I'm in my mouth. I'm not able to speak. It means why do you know?
You could use the slide.
You would change the slide.
No, I can change the slide, that's no problem.
I'm going to try it.
and the question of all colleges and the doors. There is the issue of botanical garden, Jonas and garden before. But now I don't see it. Botanical garden is very important. For example, the board of our rubber industry came to the tea garden. That came to Kerala, and today India is one of the leading producers of natural rubber and highest yield per hectare of natural rubber. Charity garden is one where I am an evident legacy, where iron deficiency is very important, or vitamin A deficiency leading to blindness is important. How to design the school garden, the genetic garden, where they provide the plants which can solve the problem, what they call agriculture remedy for nutrition benefit. So many of you have got an opportunity, you can design a garden in which it's more educational, and also then farmers can do themselves. There is a talk today about doubling the income of farmers. I won't go into detail about this. But there are ways because our income is low. That's why we want education, loan waiver, and all these credit side of largely because the income security of farms are low. The marketing opportunities are getting limited. Now, you can also increase the income scientifically. For example, the cane of rice is something which we have put up in Myanmar. At the request of the government of India. It is the one method of showing how to increase the income from the straw, the bran, the husk, and not only the grain, but also all the other parts of the plant. The total biomass, as we call that. Normally we look at only the economic part, which is the grain. Biomass utilization is one method of improving the income of the crop. The rice grow park now is selling Myanmar selling very quality paper made from the straw and also from the earth. They give the certificate, project monitoring committee, rice grow park. I mentioned earlier bio-fortified food or those which are naturally rich in the micronutrients that you need. For example, this lady, Maria Andrade from Africa, she developed along with a few others a sweet potato variety, orange fresh sweet potato, in combat to childbearing. They have done extensive work in East Africa with this variety of sweet potato, extremely effective, with the result that she was given the World Food Prize, but it's the story of me. In other words, I said genetics is a transformational science. It can transform if you use it properly. Both genetically and genetic engineering, gene editing, all of them have tremendous opportunities. It is very important we realize the value of biodiversity and conserve it. That's why I mentioned you formerly. Universities, botanical gardens used to show what is important and so on. There are methods of conservation, in situ, ex situ, and in situ, ex situ combination, and community conservation. In situ is like national parks and protected areas. Ex situ is gene banks. For example, there is one very good one in Delhi, where about 4 million seeds are preserved. One of the reasons the wonderful wonders of science is the work of Norwegians in the Svalbard Island. If you look at your atlas, you will see where the Svalbard is near the North Pole. The Svalbard, they have put up under permafrost condition. You see here at the bottom, it's called the Global Sea World. It is like Noah's Ark. When everything is lost, you can go to it. There are now nearly 7 to 8 million sea samples in this. We also have a DRDO, Defense Research Organization, has established a joint small sea world in Shangla in Himachal Pradesh. our farmers working in farm women are taking control. In fact, biodiversity conservation is largely done by women from the beginning of agriculture. When, in fact, if you, anybody here from Arunachal Pradesh, there's a temple at Alam in where there's very big portrait of a woman whom they say was the first to introduce rice into cultivation. In other words, they recognize the role of women in the production of crops, the plantation from food gathering to food growing. This food provided growing was caused by women. And men were gathering food, women were trying to convert the food. Like this lady in the Kodi Hills in Tamil Nadu maintained biodiversity by using the red crab, arhar, the red crab along with millets. She mixes the two and combines them. So they have their own method of conservation. And the final part of my talk on climate change, everybody talks about climate change. See, being there to see. Sea level rise is one area, the consequence of climate change, which is not disputed. Sea level is rising, and often, for example, today I was seeing the television, what is happening in Mumbai. Mumbai has a such a very area. A lot of people are living just on the coast. Even Kerala, you go from Kollam to Alappuzha, you'll find a large number of people living just on the coast. What is going to happen to them? With these people, we call them climate refugees. Many governments in the industrialized countries are preparing for accommodating climate refugees. Refugees caused not by war, but by climate change. Now, therefore, both temperature increase, rainfall uncertainty. Today, a week ago, we had a good monsoon. Now, if we say, either the excess rain are going to be deficit rain. So there are problems created by fairly uncertain weather conditions. One method was in India, ensuring our future is food security, because several people, populations first are really concerned. Our population is growing. And the purchasing power is increasing. It is resulting people can eat a little more than before. So both numbers of people and the revenue to buy, when they compound it, you have a continuous rise in the demand. We have been recommending for my foundation more seawater farming, because we have long sea coast with nearly 8,000 square meters, and seawater is 97% of the world's water. We go on fighting for Kaveri and other rivers, but 97% of the water is sea water, the world's water supply. How are we using it? We have shown that we can have agroforestry system and other methods of using sea water. For example, Kuttanad, Kerala, blue sea level farming was practiced 2 centuries ago. It has now been recognized as a genetically important agricultural heritage system. It's about 4 to 5 meters below sea level, they cultivate rice. So how can they do it? They put they put biobanks, what we call biobanks. The reason is in Holland, it is really a concrete plant. But here, biological material like coconut, coconut tree, they are all used to prevent the sea water from coming. You have to prevent the sea water from coming in order to cultivate rice. Rice, fish, coconut, they are very common method. Coconut in the burnt, rice and fish in the field. So there are opportunities here to increase your income and improve the food security system. For a long time, plants like this were neglected. Mangrove. We are fortunately endowed with a large variety of mangrove species. Mangrove genetic diversity is high, and it has got the ability to stabilize the soil, prevent sea erosion, soil erosion, and at the same time, if it feeds the fish Whenever backrooms are there, you'll find a lot of shrimps and fishes. Trying to give out their nutrients to the roaches and get into the water. And they are provided nutrients to animals. The information technology, most everybody, I didn't see today, I was watching. Normally people take that as by the cell phone. They are looking at the messages they have received. Today, information technology is revolutionizing the way in which we communicate. For example, this man lost his wife during the tsunami of 2004, December 26th. Next day after Christmas, large number of people died, both in Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu. All these places people are affected. This man was afraid of going to the sea in a small boat because he can afford only the country for a small boat. Today, before he gets into the boat, he looks at his cell phone and sees what will be the wave height. This information is given by one institute in Hyderabad, Promotor Jay Institute. In Coes, they provide information on sea level at from the shore to how many meters, what to be the sea level, what to be the wave height. This kind of information helps them to both collect the fish quickly and go without sea level. The number of threats to genetic sustainable development, one of them is genetic erosion. Formerly, there are some books by the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, The Lost Crops of the Incas, The Lost Crops of Africa. And formerly, food and health security depend upon 700 plant species. Today, it has become 4 or 5. When you eat today, tonight, look at how many types of grains have gone into the food, getting narrower and narrower. Mentioned the role of women in conservation. For example, this is a project in Kuli Hill. There is a Koraput property in Orissa, Koraput district. All these people, those who can read the table, we find this lady from Kanda tribe maintained over 164 varieties of medicine plants. So both health security and food security depend upon plants which have been preserved over a long period of time. Cultural and creative university. The culinary university is also important. The way in which we cook and eat. In fact, we are going to have a whole shortly conference of chefs to see how far culinary diversity can be enlarged, you know, based on local agrobiodiversity. Millions have become so important today, not only in India, but all over the world. Our government has declared this year as National Millet Year. We have been pressing also to the UN to declare one year International Millet Year. Millets were called coarse grains in the British days. Today we call them nutritional grain, and also climate smart. They are climate smart. They require much less water. There is a problem of monsoon in the market, monsoon arising from climate change. But these are the two major determinants of a farmer's well-being, the monsoon behavior and the market behavior. We have suggested different methods of preparing for it. Anticipatory, as the Nehru said, may venture the time. Anticipatory research, how to take advantage of good weather, how to avoid drought and how to avoid floods. How to avoid means to avoid the damage done by them. You can't avoid drought, you can't avoid floods. They will always come. But how do you minimize their adverse impact? In the case of market management, a very important one is the objective, minimum support price. MSP, support price is important. Support price alone is not enough, procurement is important. And public distribution is important. Public price, public procurement, public is the solution. All of them are very important. So, to suggest, to address all these problems at the level of the farmer, I chaired and mentioned by the lady who introduced me, I chaired the committee, National Commission on Farmers, where we introduced the national policy for farmers. Where the very first one, the very first goal of the national policy is to improve the economic viability of farmers by substantially increasing the net income of farmers and to measure agricultural progress by income advance, not so much only million tons. What are the great challenges for scientists? Science communication. Science communication not really among scientists themselves, one science. If you look at journals like Nature and Science, they are now increasingly in a democratic society. The parliamentarians also should know what is, as was mentioned earlier in the opening. We normally see four methods of communication between scientists and the people, and the farmers, and the public. Land to lab, land to land, land to lab. But the one which is very effective is land to land. In other words, farmer to farmer learning. Farmer is land. For example, this lady here, whom you can see, Kalevani Rajendran, she lives in Tanjore. She runs these courses. We have established farm schools in their field. And very popular courses, people come and learn about how to do right production. So finally, the gender dimension, as I mentioned earlier, agriculture is very much probably started. When women start gathering, they have to I try to develop an act of parliament in women farmers' rights. It has not, it has not, it's a private number still. Therefore, has been no priority. Any game, one day or the other, we hope both men and women, their contribution to be required, and they will very soon create help. I think, ladies and gentlemen, I have tried to highlight a few aspects of science in the last 30-40 years, most independent science, and we must be grateful to the government of India for supporting science in the way. State governments also have the State Science Commission and so on. But it's very important that both applied science and theoretical science, both is given attention. For example, the gene editing, from genetic modification to gene editing is a very big transition caused by the development. So, thank you, Dr. Ramachandran, for asking me to share a few thoughts with this wonderful group of people who have been very silent and say, I am grateful to you. Father, I am grateful to you for the opportunity. Come to the college. I also studied similar college, and therefore I value what you are doing for education. Thank you.